Welcome back, children of grade 8. I welcome you all for the today's English class. Children, in ancient education system in India is way different than what we see today. In earlier times, there was no stress of the textbook, the curricula, syllabus, assessment, etc. These systems was completely different than what we are facing today and what we are experiencing today. The British rule started it all. They changed the system entirely. But from your supplementary reader and know what was the state of education in the past times. Do you want to know what was the ancient education system? Let's do the start from numbers chapter 11 from your book It So Happened. Supplementary reader, the title of the chapter, Ancient Education System of India. Start with chapter 11, Ancient Education System of India. Let's see the sum up of part 1. Did you know that India has been the center of learning since ancient times? How did we come to know about this? There are inscriptions. Inscriptions means carving of words on stones and copper, palm leaf records, and are sculptures. Scriptures. Scriptures means holy books as evidences of the historic origins of learning in India. Today we follow an education system in which learning takes place through syllabus, curricula, textbooks, and assessment practices. Have you ever thought what these were like in the past? In this feature story, we will give you glimpse. Glimpse means quick look of our ancient education system. Let's start the introduction of the chapter. You must have heard or read that travelers from various regions having different climates and cultures began to visit parts of India from early times. To them, India was a land of wonder. The fame of Indian culture, wealth, religions, philosophies, art, architecture, as well as its educational practices had spread far and wide. The education system of ancient times was regarded as a source for the knowledge, tradition, and practice that guided and encouraged humanity. Let's move on to the next topic. Salient features of ancient education system. From the time of Rig Veda onwards, our ancient education system evolved around over the period and focused on the holistic development. Holistic means whole of the individual by taking care of both the inner and outer self. The system focused on the moral, physical, spiritual, and intellectual aspects of life. It emphasized on values such as humility, truthfulness, discipline, self-reliance, and respect for all creations. Self-reliance means independence. Students were taught to appreciate the balance between human beings and nature. Teaching and learning followed the tenets of Vedas. Tenets mean the main principles of religion and philosophy. Upanishads and fulfilling duties towards self, family, and society, thus encompassing all aspects of life. Encompassing means including. Education system focused both on learning and physical development. In other words, the emphasis was on healthy mind and healthy body. You can see that education of India has a heritage of being pragmatic. Pragmatic means practical, achievable, and complementary to life. And as we begin with the chapter, let's understand the salient features of ancient education system or important system of ancient education system. Our old education system or evolved or grown from Rig Veda time. They were more focused on moral development, physical development, spiritual development, and intellectual aspects. This type of education stressed more on values like humbleness, truthfulness, discipline in oneself, independent, and respect the all forms of life. So this kind of education basically taught about the balance between human beings and nature. And people at that time really they respected the nature and lived in harmony with the nature. They also followed teachings of Vedas and Upanishads. But more importance was given on healthy mind and healthy body. So basically they were involved in physical exercise as well as the upliftment and development of one's intelligence and mind. Children, let's see the sources of education. The ancient system of education was the education of the Vedas, Brahmanas, Upanishads and Dharma Sutras. You must have heard the names of Aryabhatta, Panini, Katyayana and Patanjali. Their writings and the medical treatise means essays of Charaka and Sushruta were also some of the sources of learning. Distinction was also drawn. Here you can see the picture, a page from manuscript of the Rig Veda. This birch bark manuscript of Rig Veda was found in Kashmir about 150 years ago. It was used to prepare one of the earliest printed texts of the Rig Veda as well as an English translation. It is now preserved in a library in Pune, Maharashtra. Heritage means something that is handed down from the past as a tradition, tenets. As a tradition, tenets means the main principles of religion or philosophy. That is learned discipline and kavyas, imaginating and creative literature. Sources of learning were drawn from various disciplines such as itihas, that is history, anvikshi, that is logic, mimansa, it is interpretation, silpashastra, architecture, arthashastra, polity, vartha, agriculture, trade, commerce, animal husbandry, and dhanurvidya is for archery. Children, look at the physical mapping of the various disciplines encompassing in the Vedas. The central part is Veda. It contains grammar, etymology, astronomy, ritual, phonetics and metrics. So these are the divisions of and various disciplines encompassed in Veda. The next topic is physical education. Physical education too was an important curricular activity area, and pupils participated in Krida, games and recreational activities, Vyam Praka, exercise, Dhanu Vidya, archery, Dhanur Vidya, archery, for acquiring martial skills, and Yoga Sadhana, training in mind and body, among others. The gurus and the other pupils worked consciously. Consciously means responsibly together to become proficient. Proficient means excel. Proficient experts in all aspects of learning. In order to access means judge pupils' learning. Shastrada, learned debates were organized. Pupil at an advanced stage of learning guided younger pupils. Also existed the system of peer learning, like you have grouped and peer work. Children, before we move on to the next point, let's have a small brief about these scholars. Let's start with Aryabhatta. Who is he? Aryabhatta was a noted mathematician and an astronomer who gave ideas about extracting square roots, solving quadratic equations, predicting lunar and solar eclipse, and of course he gave the word digit zero. Next one, Panini. Panini was a Sanskrit philologist, grammarian and scholar, and he wrote Ashtaditya.
The next scholar is Katyayana. Katyayana was a Sanskrit grammarian, mathematician, and Vedic priest. The next scholar is Patanjali. Patanjali is a sage and author of Yogachutra, which was written as a text in a book on a theory and a practice of yoga. The next person is Charak. He was a father of medicine and known for his contribution of Ayurveda, wrote Charak Shami Shahimta, a medicine essay, and a native of Kashmir. And the next scholar is Sushruta. He was a father of surgery and he was an Indian physician. And he wrote Sushrut Samhita, a medical essay, considered a foundational text of Ayurveda. Children, now let's understand the source of education. That is, what are the subjects which were included and how they were taught. Education of Vedas, Brahmanas, Upanishads and Dharma Sutras are the main education that was given on those times. And also in writings of famous scholars like Aryabhatt, Panini, Katyayana and Patanjali, along with medical essays of Charaka and Sushruta were taught to those students. And there were so many learned disciplines like Shastras and Kavyas, that is for creative writing, and were the two major dimensions of studies. Apart from this, there were various subjects included in this curricula in those days, that is the source of education for the children. These are the subjects which were taught here, that are Itihas, Anvikshihi, Mimansa, Shilpa Shastra, Adarva Shastra, Varda, Dhanurvidya. These are the subjects which were taught to those students in those days. And also much importance was given to the physical education side, for that is for games, for doing exercises, for archery and for doing yogasanas. Finally, the students were evaluated and assessed through some basis of Shastrada, on the basis of learned debates. By debates, they will discuss with the gurus and the other peer groups in the group. By this evaluation, they will be upgraded. And they have another system also, that is peer learning. Here, the older students guided the younger students, like a teacher. Move on to the next topic, that is ancient education system in India, a way of life. In ancient India, both formal and informal ways of education system existed. Indigenous means originating or occurring naturally in a particular place. Indigenous education was imparted at home in temples, padasalas, tolls, chaturpadis and gurukuls. They were people in homes, villages and temples who guided young children in imbibing. Imbibing means developing religious ways of life. Temples were also in the center of learning and took interest in the promotion of knowledge of our ancient system. Students went to Viharas. Viharas means it is a Buddhist monastery. So down you have the glossary, children. Viharas means Buddhist monastery and universities for higher knowledge. Teaching was largely oral and students remembered and meditated upon what was taught in the class. Here, Chaturpadis and tolls are the place where Vedic education was given through Rigveda, Samaveda, Yajurveda and Atharvana Veda. Gurukulas, also known as ashrams, were the residential place for the learners. Many of these were named after the sages. Situated in forests, in serene and peaceful surroundings, hundreds of students used to learn together in Gurukulas. Serene means calm. Women too had access to the education during the early Vedic period. Among the prominent women Vedic scholars, we find references to Methi, Vishwambara, Apala, Gargi, Lohambra, to name a few. During that period, the gurus and their shishyas lived together, helping each other in a day-to-day life. The main objective was to have complete learning and leading a disciplined life and realizing one's inner potential.
Students lived away from their homes for years together till they achieved their goals. The Gurukul was also the place where the relationship of the Guru and Shishya strengthened with time. While pursuing their education in different disciplines like history, pursuing means following, art of debate, law, medicine, etc. The emphasis wasn't only on the outer dimension of the discipline, but also on enriching inner dimension of the personalities also. Let's see the explanation now. When the ancient education system in India, it was not just an education system, but it was a way of life. Because local education system and education was given to the students at home in temples, patsalas, stalls, chaturpadis and gurukuls.
And they were taught religious ways of life. And viharas and universities are there for the higher educations. And also in that time, writing, teaching, writing work was very less. Instead of that, oral teachings like debate, discussion were there to assess the children and to learn things. Where gurukuls or ashrams were like hostel today, there both guru as well as shishyas will stay and they will live their life there in the ashrams. And also there were women scholars or educated, and they are Maitri, Vishwambara, Apala, Gargi, Lopamudra, etc.
Where gurus are the teachers and shishyas are the students, they both live together in gurukuls, that is ashrams, and they were educated both outer and inner development. They were educated and the education was given for both outer and inner development on that point of time. So the education is not about the one aspect of life, but it strengthened both outside and inside of both aspects. Children, we have read in part one about the system of education in those days and its curricula. Now we are going to see in part two about the two famous universities, that is Upachala and Nalanda. In part one, we have read about the ancient education system of ashram or gurukuls and the way of life in them. This system continued to flourish during the time of Buddha and the subsequent periods.
Flourished means grow.
Many monasteries, viharas, that is Buddhist monasteries, were set up for monks and nuns to meditate and debate and discuss with the learned for their quest for knowledge during this period. Around these viharas, other education centers of higher learning developed.
Monks means religious person in Buddhism. Quest means search.
Monastery means a place where monks
live and worship.
Students from China, Korea, Tibet, Burma, Ceylon, Java, Nepal and other distant countries. Let's learn about viharas and universities.
The Jataka tales accounts given by Yun Zain, also pronounced as Yun Zain, and Yi Xing, or the Sign scholars, as well as other sources, tells us that king and society take active interest in promoting education. As a result, many famous educational centers came into existence. Among the most notable universities that evolved during this period were situated at Takshashila, Nalanda, Valambi, Vikramshila, Udandapuri and Jataka. These universities developed in connection with the viharas. Those at Benares, Navdeep and Kanchi developed in connection with temples and became centers of community life in the places where they were situated. These institutions catered to the needs of advanced level students. Such students joined the centers of higher learning and developed their knowledge by mutual discussions and debates with renowned scholars. Renowned means famous scholars. Not only this, there were also occasional summoning. Summoning means ordering to be present by a king to a gathering
in which the scholars of the country of various Viharas and universities would meet, debate and exchange their views. In this section, we will give you glimpses. Glimpses means quick look of two universities of the ancient period. These universities were considered among the best centers of learning in the world. These have been recently declared heritage sites by the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, that is UNESCO. In this part, we will discuss about Viharas, that is monasteries for Buddhists, and universities. Yun Zain and Yi Jing are the two Chinese scholars and Buddhist monks who were travelers and translators. And other sources tell that the kings and the society took interest in promoting education. Many famous universities came into existence, that is Takshashila, Nalanda, Udhampuri, etc. Apart from this, also many more universities developed in connection with these Viharas, which are Benares, Navdeep and Kanchi. So students join in these universities to get their higher learning and gain knowledge through debates, discussion with famous scholars, renowned scholars. Also, kings organized gatherings where scholars of various Viharas and universities would meet and discuss with some debates, and they will exchange their views and topics. Next, let's learn about the next university, that is Takshashila or Takshala. In ancient times, Takshashila was a noted center of learning, including religious teachings of Buddhism. For several centuries, it continued to attract students from around the world until its destruction in the 5th century CE. It was known for its higher education and curriculum, comprised to study of ancient scriptures. Scriptures means holy books, law, medicine, astronomy, military science, and the 18 siplas or arts. Takshashila became famous as a place of learning due to its teacher expertise. Among its noted pupils were the legendary Indian grammarian Panini. He was an expert in language and grammar and authored one of the greatest works of grammar called Ashtadhyayi. Jivaka, one of the most renowned physicians in ancient India, and Chanakya, also known as Kautilya, a skilled exponent of statecraft, both studied here. Students came to Takshashila from Kashi, Kosala, Magadha, and also from other countries in spite of the long and arduous journey they had to undertake. Postage stamp of Indian grammarian Panini. You can see the picture here, children. Takshashila was an ancient Indian city which is now in northwestern Pakistan. It is an important archaeological site, and the UNESCO declared it to be a World Heritage Site in the year 1980. Its fame rested on the university where Chanakya is said to have composed his Arthashastra. Archaeologist Alexander Cunningham discovered its ruins in the mid of 19th century. Takshashila or Takshila. In ancient times, Takshashila was a noted center of learning, including religious teaching of Buddhism. For several countries, it continued to attract students from around the world until its destruction in the 5th century CE. It was known for its higher education, and the curriculum comprised the study of ancient scriptures, law, medicine, astronomy, military science, and 18 siplas or art. Takshashila became famous as a place of learning due to its teaching expertise. Among its noted pupils were the legendary Indian grammarian Panini.
He was an expert in language and grammar and authored one of the greatest work of grammar called Ashtadhyayi. Jivaka, one of the most renowned physicians in ancient India, and Chanakya was known as Kautilya, skilled exponent of statecraft. Exponent means practitioner. Statecraft means skills of managing state affairs. Both studied here. Students came from Takshashila, from Kasi, Kosala, Magadha, and also from other countries. In spite of the long and arduous journey they had to undertake. Arduous means difficult. Takshashila are the center of higher learning, including religious teachings of Buddhism. But it was destroyed in 5th century CE. Curriculum of this university based on scriptures, law, medicine, astronomy, military science, and 18 silpas art. And the teachers were the experts here. And the famous students who were passed out in this university are Panini, who was a grammarian and wrote book Ashtadhyayi, and Jivaka, who was the doctor, and Chanakya, who was the expert in the managing state. And students came from far and wide places like Kashi, Kosala, Magadha, and from other countries to study here in this university and to get higher knowledge. Role of a teacher. Teachers had complete autonomy. Autonomy means freedom in all aspects, from selection of students to designing their syllabi. Syllabi means the portion or the plural form of syllabus. When the teacher was satisfied with the performance of the students, the course concluded. Concluded means ended. Autonomy means freedom to act on one's will. Statecraft means the skill of governing a country. He would admit as many students as he liked and taught what his students were keen to learn. Debate and discussion were the primary methods of teaching. Teachers were assisted. Assisted means helped by their advanced level students. So this is what the role of teacher in the olden times. Now let's see what was the role of the teacher in the olden times. Teachers had all the freedoms, from selection of students to designing of their course. The course ended only when the teacher was satisfied with the performance of the students. The number of students is depend on the wish of the teacher, and the teacher taught what the students were interested in learning. And teaching was done only through debates and discussion. So more or less, it was oral or vocal teaching learning process. Even senior students helped their teachers, or to the younger students to imparting their knowledge. Next university is Nalanda University. The ancient Nalanda was the center of learning from the 5th century CE to 12th century CE. Located in present-day Rajgarh, Bihar, India, Nalanda was one of the oldest universities of the world, and UNESCO declared the ruin of Nalanda Mahavihara a World Heritage Site. The new Nalanda University is envisaged. Envisaged means imagined as the center of inner civilizational dialogue. University Nalanda, when Yun Zain visited it, it was called as Nala and was the center of higher learning in various subjects. The university attracted scholars from the different parts of the country as well as world. The Chinese scholars Ai Jing and Yuan Zhen visited Nalanda in the 7th century CE. They have given vivid accounts of Nalanda. They have noted that as many as 100 discourses happen on a daily basis in a variety of disciplines through the method of debate and discussion. Yuan Zhen himself became a student of Nalanda to study Yoga Shastra. He was mentioned that the Chancellor of Nalanda, Badra, was the highest living authority in yoga. The courses of study offered by Nalanda University covered a wide range, almost the entire circle of knowledge then available. Students at Nalanda studied the Vedas and were also trained fine arts. medicine, mathematics, astronomy, politics, and the art of warfare. After the destruction of Takshala University in 5th century CE, Nalanda University came into existence. So,
Yu Xing and Yu Zhang visited Nalanda in the 7th century. There they observed about 100 discussions happen every day. Discussions were in the form of debates and discourses. The Chancellor of Nalanda, known as Shailabhadra, was the highest authority in yoga. This university attracted scholars from all around the country and around the world. Even Yu Zhang is one of the students of that university and he studied Yoga Shastra. Different subjects were offered in this university, such as study of Vedas, fine arts, medicine, mathematics, astronomy, politics, and the art of warfare. Next, we are going to see role of community. At that time, knowledge was considered sacred and no fee was charged. Contributions towards education were considered the highest form of donation. All members of the society contributed in some form or the other. Financial support came from rich merchants, wealthy parents, and society. Besides gifts of buildings, the universities received gifts of land. This form of free education was also prevalent. Prevalent means common in other ancient universities like Vallabhi, Vikramshila, and Jagatala. At the same time, in the south of India, Agraharas served as a center of learning and teaching. South Indian kingdoms also had other cultural institutions known as Gatika and Brahmapuri. Gatika was the center of learning including religion and was small in size. And Agraharas was the bigger institution, a whole settlement of learned Brahmins with its own power of government and was maintained by generous donations from the society. Temples, Mahatas, Jain Basadis and Buddhist Viharas also existed as other source of learning during this period. Now let's see what role the community played in the Indian education system in that time. Knowledge was considered godliness and it was considered as sacred and no fees was charged. Wealthy parents and society gave financial support in the form of donation, gift of buildings and land. Education was free and it was given in other universities also like Vallabhi, Vikramshila and Jagatala. In south of India, Agraharas were center of teaching and learning run by Brahmins and maintained by donations. Gatikas were the center of learning including religion but smaller in size. Temple, Matahas, Jain Basadis and Buddhist Viharas also exist as other source of learning. The next heading is continuation of Indian education system. The Indian education system continued in the form of ashrams, temples and as indigenous schools. During the medieval period, taps and madrasas became part of the education system. While madrasas provide elementary and higher education in religious and or regular, but maktabs are neighborhood schools often attached to that provide religious education to children who attend other schools to get mainstream education. During the pre-colonial period means before the British rule, indigenous education flourished in India. This was an extension of the formal system that had taken roots earlier. This system was mostly religious and spiritual form of education. Schools in Bengal, Pathshalas in Western India, Chaturpadis in Bihar and similar school existed in other parts of India. Local resources via donations supported education. References in text and memoir means historical records, inform that villages also supported education in southern India. As we understand, the ancient education system of India focused on holistic development of the students, both inner and outer self, thus preparing them for life. Education was free and not centralized. These foundations were laid in the rich cultural traditions of India, thereby helping in the development of physical, intellectual, spiritual and artistic aspects of the life holistically. Holistically means fully. Our present day education system has a lot to learn from the ancient education system of India. Therefore, the stress is being laid on connecting learning to the world outside the school. Today, educationists recognize the role and importance of multilingual. Multilingual means using many languages is known as multilingual. And multicultural education, thereby connecting the ancient and the traditional knowledge with contemporary. Contemporary means modern learning. So that's all from the supplementary reader, last chapter, chapter 11, Ancient Education System of India Children. Let's see the explanation of this last paragraph now. So how did the Indian education system continue? When it continued in ashrams, temples and local or native schools, when the medieval period came, there were maktabs and madrasas came up as center of education. During those times, there were religious and spiritual form of education were given to the children and to the students. Society supported the education via donation because the education then was free. Education focused on holistic development, both inner and outer self, and education was free and not centralized. It was based on cultural traditions of India. This kind of system and education helped in physical, intellectual, spiritual and artistic aspects of life of every person. That present day education system is trying to connect with the ancient system, because today it is a much different thing than what we had in the ancient times. But today's educationalists are recognizing the importance of multilingual, including multiple languages and multiple cultures in the education system, so that maximum knowledge can be given to our children. So children, that's all from the supplementary reader, chapter 11, Ancient Education System of India. Go through the story and understand the things. Learn the question answers thoroughly and write the classwork neatly.